Hello, and welcome to part 6 of our 7-part series on Windows Server 2012 R2, the Essentials Experience. So here we're covering the features and functionality that used to be available only in the Essentials Edition, but now is also available as an optional role that you can install in the Standard and Data Center Editions as well. So in this presentation, we'll be looking at management of users and computers. So let's go ahead and get started. So we'll begin with just a quick overview of user management. We'll talk about creating and editing, viewing the properties of user accounts. We'll also look at the client connector. So this is the wizard that is used to join computers in an Essentials environment to the server. So a little bit easier than the typical domain join manual process. And we'll also look at managing the client computers, viewing their properties and so on. So let's dive right on in. We'll get started with user management. And in an Essentials environment, user management and the identity of users is controlled, organized, managed using the typical Active Directory domain services that you would find in all the editions of Windows Server. What we do is just to make this a little bit easier to get started with and to manage on a day-to-day basis. But Active Directory is what's going to provide the authentication and the authorization aspects of user identity. So here you would create user accounts, you assign them usernames, passwords. This is a little bit different than, say, in kind of a peer-to-peer network that doesn't have a central identity management, where you might just have local usernames, you may or may not be using passwords on local machines. It's a little bit more ad hoc. So in an Essentials environment, or really any Windows Server environment that has Active Directory, now we have this kind of central repository controlled by usernames and passwords. We also have the ability to define a password policy and enforce that. So this lets us do things like set a minimum password complexity policy, decide whether or not passwords should expire so that they need to be changed on a regular basis, and things of that nature. Basically, what we've done is kind of simplify this experience for smaller environments. And with the role now present in Standard and Data Center, smaller environments can mean up to 100 users and up to 200 devices when you're using the role in those larger editions. So still, the idea being that it's a little bit easier to use Active Directory using the Windows Server Essentials dashboard that we provide. As you're creating user accounts, they can be set up as either standard users or administrative users. And this is a little bit simpler than what you might think of in a traditional Active Directory environment. But again, it's a little bit more than you would get in kind of that peer-to-peer environment, where typically everyone is an administrator. And here we just have these kind of two levels to give you some basic control over who has access to what resources and how you can control that in the environment. One of the other things that we do here is disable the built-in administrator account. So what we do as part of the setup process for the Essentials experience is to prompt for the creation of a user account that's going to be set as an administrative user. And then that user is what you would use to log into to do administrative functions. But the built-in administrator account is disabled just as a best practices type of security policy. Now, when we look at managing individual user accounts, there's a specific page we have in the Windows Server Essentials dashboard that allows you to do that. It's going to show you all of the user accounts in the environment, and then you have a number of tasks that you can perform. Some tasks apply to all users in general, things like creating a new user account, but you can also, as I mentioned, set that global password policy. You can manage file history settings for users in the environment. In previous versions of Essentials, file history was managed on a per PC basis, but now it's managed on a per user basis. So this gives a little bit more flexibility in terms of what file history backups are made for each individual user, and allows some more flexibility in the restore options as well. You can also use the dashboard to export a log of remote connections. So this is a new enhancement again in Essentials in the 2012 R2 wave, where we do much more management of those remote connections and can give you a view of who is connecting to the environment remotely and what they're doing. You can also manage online services, different add-ins that can be included in the Essentials environment can extend the user management functionality. And so if you do that, Office 365 is a great example, then the management of the specific online services becomes integrated into the dashboard, and then you're able to do that here as well. So tasks that are specific to just individual user accounts include being able to view the user account properties, to deactivate or to remove a user account, and to change the user's password. Again, you can also manage online services specifically for any individual user in the environment. Now, when we look at setting the user's access level and the password policy, as I mentioned, we've simplified the user accounts into just being standard users or administrative users. So there's a lot more that Active Directory can do. And of course, you can use Active Directory behind the scenes to be more granular in the policies that you set. But to keep things simple, especially in smaller environments, really just those two levels pretty much provide all of the flexibility, all of the control that you probably will need. Also, in terms of the password policy that you can select, we have just a little slider bar that goes all the way from weak all the way up to strong. And typically, we would recommend certainly strong passwords. So this requires at least 8 characters and also a combination of letters and numbers and symbols just to help really secure things, especially as the environment is accessible remotely, so via the internet, or if you've integrated with Office 365 and the mailboxes are, of course, available through the internet, then strong password policies are really required to protect that sensitive business data that you have. So making it easy through the dashboard to set user access levels as you create user accounts, and also password policies that apply to all the users. Now, another thing that is new in the 2012 R2 release of Windows Server is for the Essentials experience is the introduction, or maybe even the reintroduction, of security and distribution groups. So when Essentials was first designed, it was really targeted at the smallest of user environments, and so for up to 25 users. And today we still have that, the idea that when you purchase the Essentials Edition, then you can use it with up to 25 user accounts. And in that type of an environment, user groups may or may not be very useful. You can assign access to resources on an individual user account basis, and that is often as much as you need, especially if you only have 5, maybe 10 users. But as we've introduced the role and made this accessible in standard and data center as well, the environments that you can use Essentials experience with grow a little bit larger. And in this case, having user groups, it becomes a much, much easier way to control access to resources. So if you're familiar at all with Windows Small Business Server, the standard editions, which supported up to 75 users, then they, of course, had user groups and distribution groups. And now we've just reintroduced that back into the dashboard for the Essentials and the Essentials experience as well. So again, as you use security groups, that's going to allow you to control access to resources in the environment. If you've optionally integrated with email, whether that's Exchange Server on-premise or Office 365, then you can also use the dashboard to create distribution groups so that you can send an email to a group and have it go to a number of different users. So again, that's just a little bit easier as the user count in the environment gets a little larger. So again, I know I kind of breezed past this pretty quickly, so I'll just summarize one last time. The Essentials Edition still is the same as it has been in the past, with up to 25 users that you can create, granted by that Essentials Edition server license. But with the Essentials Experience role available in Standard Edition, then you can just buy as many user cows as you want. And the Essentials Experience will allow you to manage We recommend up to 100 users and 200 devices. The dashboard certainly won't break at that point, but at that point you probably have enough users that it makes sense to start using the native tools as you manage your user accounts. Okay, so as we look at creating and editing user accounts in the Essentials environment, we've made it a little easier to create those user accounts. Now, if you've looked at Active Directory just in a normal Windows Server environment, you may be familiar with the property pages in Active Directory Users and Computers, and there are dozens, if not hundreds, of options that you have and properties that you can set for your user accounts. In the Essentials environment, we've just kind of streamlined and simplified that experience and really just honed in on the things that are most important. So as you create a new user, there's a fairly simple add user wizard that allows you to simply enter in the user's full name. It will automatically provide a default username, but you can modify that as desired. You can enter a password, which again is going to meet those policies that you've set up, the requirements for that. You can also specify that access level, whether it's standard or administrator. Again, if you have optionally integrated with an email backend, whether that's Exchange server running on premises, or if it's Office 365, or if it's hosted Office or a hosted Exchange provided by a third party, any of those ways, then you would see a page in the Add User Wizard to create an associated mailbox for that user. You can also now assign users into groups, and you can assign access rights for users to shared folders in the environment. And then finally, you can select the anywhere access settings. So do they have the ability to connect to the environment through a virtual private network? Do they have the ability to access the remote web access web portal, which lets them connect remotely to computers in the office, gives them the web-based access to shared folders and things of that nature. So these are all things that you can do as you're creating the user accounts, but again, a lot of the complexity of using Active Directory users and computers is really not shown in these wizards. It's kind of just hidden to make the process really focused on what's important, especially in smaller environments. Now, if we look at the user account properties that you can set and modify after the fact, again, you can come in and change a user's first and last name. You can't change their user account name after you've created the account. If you want the entire username to be changed, then you would have to delete the account and create the new account with the name that you want. But you can switch between standard and administrator access levels. You can change the password for the user. You can disable or re-enable an account. Now, this is different than just deleting an account entirely. If you have somebody who's going away, perhaps for an extended period of time, you may just want to disable the account to make sure that nobody is logging in as that user. It's a little bit of a good security best practice, but you know that person's coming back, so you just want to have all of their settings and all of their access controls just as they were, and then you can re-enable that at a later time. You can also join and leave user groups for this particular user. You can manage their shared folder and anywhere access settings if you need to modify those after having created the account. Again, you can optionally manage their mailbox settings if you have it integrated with email, and you can specify which computers in the environment the user can connect to remotely. So in many cases, especially for standard users, they would only be able to connect to their own computer. Although you may have computers in the environment that are used to run specific applications, and as an example, you may want to give particular users access to those computers as well, potentially as their own, or you might want to give several users the ability to access a computer that's running an application in the environment. And so you can do that through the property pages of the user accounts. So really, that's as easy as it is to create and manage users in the Essentials environment. So now let's look at the Client Connector software. So also known as the Connect Computer Wizard, this is the way that you can easily join computers into the Essentials environment. So it starts out as just launching a web page through the web browser. And not only does it support client computers, but you can also run this on Windows Server computers with 2008 R2 and later. So this just automates some of the concepts around joining computers into an Active Directory environment. So you could do it manually, but it tends to be easier to do with the wizard, and then you get all of the different settings that the wizard will help you do, including things like installing some of the components that are necessary for things like being able to launch the dashboard, be able to launch the launch pad, which is a great jumping off point for things. It also provides any of the prerequisite software that may be needed, such as the .NET framework, to support these things. So generally speaking, it's a very good idea to simply use the Connect Computer Wizard for your normal PCs in the environment. And even on the servers in the environment. Although again, there's nothing stopping you from manually joining computers into the Essentials environment if you need to do that or want to do that for specific reasons. Just be aware that if you're going to go down that route, then it makes sense that you have some better level of familiarity with the way Windows Server and Active Directory works. And for smaller environments, again, where you just want kind of the simplest approach, the Connect Computer Wizard is exactly the way to go. One of the other things that the wizard does is really simplify user profile migration. This is for the pro SKUs of Windows Server. So let's say you are in a peer-to-peer environment and you have users who have personalized their environment. They've got a particular desktop background, they've got shortcuts and documents on their desktop, and when you join a domain, you'll actually get a new profile, new user profile on that machine. And if you join manually, you have to deal with that manually. You have to copy over the files that you want from the old profile to the new profile. You have to reset up the personalization settings and things like that. That's one of the things that the wizard takes care of for you. So one good reason to go ahead and use that. So again, as I mentioned, you launch the Connect Computer Wizard from your browser. This is very easy to do in a local environment, but you can also do this remotely. So starting with 2012, remote users can connect via VPN, which is automatically established when you start the Connect Computer Wizard. So in this case, there's no media that you have to distribute. There's no file share or SMB share. And here, SMB, I'm referring to the protocol, the file sharing protocol. There isn't anything special that you have to do. You just go to the web page, start that up, and if you are remote from the server, it will automatically establish a VPN connection, and then that will allow you to join into the domain for the Essentials environment. So that's pretty slick. Again, as I mentioned, there are a number of benefits that you get when you connect client computers to the environment. Some of the things that we're able to do now is to monitor the health of the computers through the dashboard. We can automatically initiate client computer backups, and the backups are then stored on the Essentials server, and this lets us do things like backup or restore individual files and folders, or even the entire PC. You have the ability to manage the Essentials server from the client. So from that domain joined client, you can launch the dashboard and do the administration that you need. So there's never really a reason, after you have things up and going, to sit down in front of the Essentials server itself just to do management. So again, as you're getting connected, you can launch that server. If you're local, you just put in the name of the server /connect. If you're connecting remotely, then you would typically use remote and then dot your internet domain name /connect. You can change the remote part, but most people don't. It's a little bit easier just to kind of keep things the way it's expected. Especially if you're a partner, you want all of your customers kind of set up in the same way. So one of the things that we'll do to get started, again, as I mentioned, is to install any prerequisite software that it may need that may or may not require a reboot of the client computer. Once that's done, it goes through the rest of the wizard. The user provides their credentials. If you do try to connect using the admin account, it will warn you. Typically, you would want to set this up for a standard user in the environment to do their day-to-day tasks. You might be using an admin account if you're running the Connect Computer Wizard on a server, for example, and getting that set up again so that you can see health alerts for the servers that you have in your environment right within the dashboard. And again, as I mentioned, you have the choice to go ahead and move user settings and their data. So this makes it so that you don't have two independent, well, you still do have two independent user profiles, but you can migrate the settings from like a local computer profile into that domain user profile. So it just makes it a little bit easier on end users because they retain their the personalized settings in that familiar environment that they had set up. And then finally, you go ahead and enter in a computer description. This is just what you'll see in the dashboard. So it just makes it easy to tell which computer is which. And then we finish up by deciding whether or not we want to wake the computer up if it's in sleep mode in order to do a client computer backup. So typically this is done, although you may have occasion where you don't want the computer to wake up. Perhaps it's not used very often and doing daily backups isn't as necessary. You just want to do backups as the computer is used or when the computer is used, and so you might want to just let it sleep to save power. And then once you're connected, you are ready to go. At this point, you can do things like start the launch pad. You can optionally launch the dashboard and basically interact with the Essentials environment with a domain-joined PC. I also wanted to include a list of the supported clients. The best thing to do if you have any question is to visit that TechNet page to get the latest and greatest, most up-to-date list of clients. But here we can see that the supported clients include Windows 7 operating systems, Windows 8 operating systems, and we also still have Mac support for Mac OS X 10.5 through to the current, at least of today, as of today, the current 10.8. So now I want to look at managing the client computers. So again, as you go into the dashboard and go to the devices page, you're able to see every computer and server in the environment. So this really helps to get an at-a-glance view of the health of the entire environment. You can see update status for all of the computers. You can see security status where that's applicable. You can see whether or not some group policies have been implemented to make the computers safer. You can see any health alerts that are applicable to any of the computers in the environment. So a number of things that you can do, again, very similar to user management. There are tasks that apply to all computers, and these include customizing the client computer backup. So here we can do things like set the time interval during which client computer backups are run. Typically this is overnight, but depending on the specific needs of the business, you may want to adjust the time frame during which backups are made. You can also get some help with how to connect client computers and what the implications of that are, and you can also choose to implement or modify the group policy that gets pushed out to the domain joined client computers. And we'll talk a little bit more about that here in a second. So the tasks that you can do for individual computers in the environment, of course, you can view their properties. You can look at the backup and restore tasks. So you can restore files and folders for an individual PC this way. You could start a manual backup. You can customize the selected computer's backup, so you can decide which aspects, which files and folders and things get backed up for that client computer. You can establish a remote desktop connection to a particular PC to help with to help an end user do some troubleshooting, whatever may need to be done. You can remove a user, you can remove a computer from the dashboard if it's no longer in use, if it's been retired or replaced, lost or stolen, whatever the case may be, and you just want to remove it from the environment, you can go ahead and do that here. And then if you select the actual essential server itself, you can also view the results of the best practices analyzer, and this will give you some additional insight into the health and proper configuration of the server itself. So one of the things I wanted to mention during this section is just some thinking about what is the right addition of the Windows client in order that you should use in a business environment. And this typically comes down to kind of a choice between home and professional SKUs. So in many cases, especially if the business is quite small, we see folks going out to local retail stores and just picking up a desktop or a laptop and bringing that back and wanting to use that in a business environment. And often in those retail outlets, you'd find computers with home SKUs. So you can use the home SKUs of Windows to connect to the Essentials environment, but you give up quite a bit of functionality and ease of use when you do that. So you get quite a bit of additional value when you do use the Pro SKUs, and you're able to implement group policy with the Pro SKUs, including things like folder redirection and various security settings. So if we look at the home SKUs, you'll get basic connectivity. So you'd be able to access shared folders, be able to open and edit and save files on the network. But in order to do that, you're going to need to put in your credentials every time, or you're going to need to manually sync the username and password on the local PC to a domain username and password. And it's easy to get those out of sync and to be continuously prompted for credentials. So it's not a very good experience for users in the environment. So when you do step up to the professional SKUs, of course, you're going to get better productivity. You're going to get better management of the computer itself. The users won't have to be continuously prompted for credentials, so they can just focus on the work that they actually need to do. And you have the pass-through authentication. You'll also be able to connect to Pro SKUs remotely, so they provide the remote desktop support that's necessary in order to connect to those from a remote location. So those just some thoughts on using the Pro SKUs as opposed to the home SKUs, especially in a business environment. So I mentioned the group policies a couple of times. Now, all of the group policy settings and things that you can do in a Windows Server environment are available, of course, but we've also made it easy to get going with a few just basic policies that really help protect your data and make it easier to protect the environment as a whole, really. So one of the first things that you're able to do is turn on folder redirection, and this just allows the typical files and folders in the user's profile to be saved to the central Essentials server. And this applies to things like the desktop, the documents folders, your downloads folder, and things like that. So again, it makes it easy to centrally protect and back up this type of data. So it's often used in an environment that has a central server. In addition to that, you can enforce some best practices security policies for the client computers, and this includes things like making sure that Windows Update is turned on so that client computers are automatically getting updates as they become available. You can also enforce the use of Windows Defender, so this helps with getting some anti-malware updates and helping to protect the client computers, as well as being able to enforce that the network firewall has to be turned on. So typically this is done all the time anyway, but perhaps you have a laptop that's taken home by one of your employees, and one of their kids is wanting to play some kind of game or do some kind of something, and they're just experimenting around, and they turn off the network firewall, and then you can become infected with malware or Trojans or things like that. Having the security policy turned on and using group policies to enforce that the network firewall has to be turned on and stay turned on can prevent issues like that from occurring in the environment. And of course, keeping viruses out of of your environment is a great way to protect not only the individual computer, but all of the computers and all of the servers in the environment. So really, I highly encourage you to do that. So that is a quick look at managing the users and computers in an essentials environment. I just wanted to finish up with some next step, make sure that you're aware of some of the great resources that we have available for you. There's a ton more technical information on Windows Server and the Essentials experience available on the Tech Center, so please do check that out. We also have a very active blog, so encourage you to check that out. RSS feed is a great way to go to stay current on what's happening with the blog. We have posts from the dev team about features, from the customer service and support team about things to be aware of, issues that come up that we know about that we want to make sure that the community is aware of. We post some marketing and upcoming product information on the blog. It's a cross-section of everything that you need to know about the product, so a really, really great resource. And then also we have a very active support forum, so would highly encourage you to check that out if you have any questions. This is monitored and maintained by the dev team. We have a very active MVP community that really helps out a lot. And then, of course, we have our product page where you can go and get more information, download the trial, get data sheets, white papers for Windows Server 2012 R2 all up, as well as the specific product page for Essentials as well. And then I have a few things I wanted to share in terms of partner resources. We have our Ahead of the Game campaign, and I wanted to make sure that you're aware of that, so I wanted to include this slide. We have some additional partner resources that I just wanted to make sure you had quick and easy access to. We also have a number of ways that you can go ahead and buy Windows Server 2012 R2, so I wanted to give you a quick feature overview and give you some more information there. We have a number of product and licensing resources. Again, I just wanted to include this in the deck for your reference. And then finally wrapping up with the various programs that we have in terms of licensing for our small and mid-sized businesses. So thank you very much for joining me for this presentation on managing users and computers in the Essentials environment. And I hope you'll join us for additional sessions in this series.